Welcome, friends, to the first of the lecture series as part of the new Mellon Seminar on Violence and Nonviolence at the Mahindra Humanities Center. Delighted to see you all here today, and extraordinarily pleased that our first Mellon lecture will be delivered by Professor Partha Chatterjee, who is a professor of anthropology at Columbia University, really does need no introduction whatsoever, but he is honorary professor and former director of the Center for Studies in Social Sciences in Calcutta. Amongst his books, A Nationalist Thought in the Colonial World, A Derivative Discourse, 86, The Nation and Its Fragments, 93, and in more recent times, the really superb Politics of the Governed, Reflections on Popular Politics in Most of the World, 2004, and then The Black Hole of Empire, History of a Global Practice of Power, which is the kind of text behind this evening's lecture. He's also a founding member of the Subaltern Studies Collective. That made such an impact, initially, of course, in the study of post-colonial Indian history, colonial and post-colonial Indian history, and then went on to greatly influence European historians and also Latin American historians, particularly with its turn to a very inventive and revisionist Gramscian reading. This evening's event, as I've just said, is taking place in connection with the Mahindra Center's new three-year Andrew Mellon Foundation Seminar on Violence and Nonviolence. Partha Chatterjee's wisdom and advice have been crucial in the conception and design of the seminar, and I want to thank him and a number of other colleagues from across Harvard campus and elsewhere for their generosity and guidance. Richard Tuck and Noah Feldman, in their own way, have been more than good friends to this program and are in continual conversation with us about the shape of it, and I'm very grateful to both of you. Thank you very much. Elaine Scarry, who is here too, is a friend of the seminar and somebody who guides us, Vincent Brown, Amy Hollywood, Joseph Kerner, Jeannie Sook, Jacqueline Baba, Uday Singh Mehta, Alex DeWall, Carol Steiker, Alan Thomas, Jennifer Leaning. I feel I really must give you the role of honor today. Charles Mayer, John Hamilton, Diana Sorensen, Sugato Bose, David Damrosch, and Peter Gallison. I also want to thank our seminar coordinator, Suzanne Smith, who is, yeah, there you are, Suzanne, who's been doing a great job. The next public event in connection with the seminar, a Monday evening screening and discussion of Peter Davis's classic Academy Award-winning Vietnam film, Hearts and Minds, at 7 p.m. at the Harvard Film Archive, followed by Etienne Balibar's visit November the 4th and 5th, and where he will deliver lectures on recent work that he's been doing on violence, civility, and Politics Revisited at 6 p.m. in Emerson Hall on both days. Now, the Mellon Seminar explores a different dimension of the interrelationship between violence and nonviolence as disciplinary formation, historical event, ideological or ethical discourse, each year a new turn around this problem. This year's topic is war. Next year's seminar will focus on everyday violence across the insistent yet unstable boundaries between the public and the private. The aims of the seminar and the public events we're organizing around it are twofold. First, we seek to study violence and nonviolence in a comparative global context to advance our knowledge of their complex relationship and with a view to understanding the role played by violent and nonviolent engagements in different historical and political and cultural contexts. Now, beyond this epistemological purpose, Our second aim is to engage in a pedagogical inquiry into the construction of knowledges of violence, nonviolence, relative to the framing or holding capacities of different scholarly disciplines, to consider this double movement by which disciplines are both compelled to conserve their pedagogical authority and yet impelled by historical and institutional changes to open up to emergent, interstitial, interdisciplinary forms of knowledge. So the seminar for the next 3 years looks at both these things, the epistemological and the pedagogical. It's a kind of a critique of disciplinarity and a critique of interdisciplinarity at the same time as building up an archive on the interrelationship of violence and nonviolence. There could be no speaker more appropriate to the spirit of this inaugural event than Partha Chatterjee, whose work reflects both the aim and the architecture of the Mellon Seminar at the Mahindra Center. There are few writers, whether historians or political philosophers, who have so profoundly explored the vicissitudes of violence, historical, cultural, legal, ethical, or governmental. Partha's meticulous tracings of the lineages of the colonial and post-colonial state are phased inquiries into the relations of sovereignty and subalternity played out in a range of contexts and conditions. What is salutary about his perspective on popular politics in most of the world, to steal one of his titles, is his insistence on building a global argument on foundational ideas and events that emerge from what he names the rule of colonial difference. The rule and misrule of empire are normalizations of the violence of subjugation embedded in world-conquering ideologies such as colonization, nationalism, positivism, neoliberalism, even secular humanism. Normalization dissipates and disguises violence by making a rational and universal appeal, often to the binarisms of the civilized and the uncivilized, the developed and the developing, the North and the South, custom and contract, believers and non-believers. The brilliance in Partha's use of the rule of difference, what makes it historically both extendable and regionally expandable, lies in his awareness that difference cuts both ways despite the directionality of power relations. Once alterity and otherness become part of systems of regulation and representation, they introduce contradictions and ambivalence into the rule of governmentality that can politically be suppressed but won't be ethically silenced. And here we might think of a kind of post-colonial notion of the state of exception in across, you know, regions that are not nations but considered to be protectorates, etc. This is what we were talking about just before coming here as to how that might work. It is this line of thinking that Partha follows in his critique of the singularity of the nationalist idea of India, never more germane than now, and it is at the very heart of his critique of today's global empire, as he calls it, democracy without a substantial framework for democratic accountability or moral legitimacy. In a passage in The Black Hole of Empire, Partha writes of the imperial origins of the problem of international law and the pedagogy of violence. And I just give this to you as a little cue. Even though, he writes, in the course of their imperial advance, European powers, such as the British, had ventured into various treaties and agreements with Oriental rulers and chieftains, were the latter really to be regarded as sovereign entities? To admit this would be to acknowledge that the family of sovereign nations that was the source of international law included such non-European members. On the other hand, to deny them any sovereign authority would imply that the treaties they had entered into with European powers had no legal standing. The problem dogged imperial policy in the 19th century. goes on to say, the formula, democracy at home, despotism abroad. Of course, this is something very close to what John Stuart Mill himself said. I'm a democrat at home and a despot abroad. What does that make of me? is perfectly applicable now, Partha writes, in the 21st century, in the realist discourses of national interest. 8 months after the liberation of Iraq, Lieutenant Colonel Sassaman of the US occupying forces was heard to say, quote, with a heavy dose of fear and violence and a lot of money for projects, I think we can convince these people that we're here to help them. Even today, writes Partha, the pedagogy of violence must often precede the pedagogy of culture. The Mellon Seminar convenes its discussions and debates at the intersection of the pedagogies of violence and the formations of culture. Partha's contribution to the pedagogic aim of our seminar lies in his ability to decipher how hegemony is as much a configuration of forces as it is a concatenation of discourses. Violence and nonviolence are made manifest in action and event, but they're made memorable and expressive in acts of enunciation, figuration, and conversation. To comprehend how our disciplines shape our will to knowledge and constitute what is curricular and extracurricular is a first step in determining the morality of our scholarly enterprise and in taking responsibility for a world that we change and that changes us in our acts of attention and interpretation. Please join me in welcoming Partha Chatterjee.
Thank you very much, Homi, for inviting me and for that very generous introduction, and also for that little trailer to my talk. Because what I will speak about today is largely out of my recently published book, The Black Hole of Empire. And the reason I chose to speak about this was, in fact, the theme of the year, or is it over several years, in fact, which the theme being nonviolence, violence, and nonviolence, which for some reason I keep remembering as war and peace. But, and I now know why, because the theme for this year is, in fact, war. So, in this talk, I will tell you a story about the 19th century, when the law of nations was explicitly tied up with empire's law. But, as I hope to make evident, it's a story that still rings true today. Not as a parable, because there is no simple moral truth that I wish to proclaim, but as a genealogy of some of the techniques of power that are still employed in the arena of world politics. My story, then, is an excavation of our collective memory to caution us against the overly hopeful expectations we might have of using power in the pursuit of the good. So, the law of nations in the East. The practices of modern empire in the 19th century emerged within a new conceptual frame developed by Jeremy Bentham and the utilitarians, who proposed that governments everywhere, in every part of the world, could be compared and ranked according to a common set of measures. Hence, certain universal norms could be fixed against which each country could be measured and its deviation from the norm identified. Suitable policies could then be devised for bringing the governments of those countries closer to the universally desirable norm. Empire thus came to be thought of as a new educational project of normalization, i.e. disciplining. The techniques ranged between two types, a pedagogy of violence and a pedagogy of culture. While culture increasingly became the preferred method, including legal reform, reform of social and economic institutions, and the spread of Western-style education, it was asserted at the same time that the proper conditions for cultural pedagogy may often have to be ensured by the use of imperial force. The history of imperialism since the 19th century is fundamentally characterized by debates over the degree, sequence, combination, and points of application of the pedagogical techniques of violence and culture. The normative considerations involved questions of both morality and law. Occupying a central place in these debates of imperial policy was the concept of sovereignty. In each case where the issue came up of whether or how much to intervene, the application of moral as well as legal norms required a determination of the existence and quality of sovereignty. The striking fact, even though largely unacknowledged until quite recently, is that the evolving practices of imperial power in the Americas, Asia, and Africa had a profound effect in shaping the so-called law of nations and in defining the place within it of the modern sovereign nation state. Looking at the debates that took place in the 16th and 17th centuries about the moral and legal propriety of the European conquest of the Americas, and those in the 18th century about the British territorial acquisitions in India, one notices a significant shift in the discursive conditions. Broadly speaking, the shift is from the debates between the scholastics and the humanists in the earlier period to the natural law theorists of the later period. In the legal domain, the ruling ideas governing the acquisition of territory in India in the 18th century were those of Grotius, while the moral political argument tended to come largely out of Montesquieu. In the 19th century, alongside the emergence of utilitarian reasoning in political affairs, the legal domain was marked by the rise of positivism, of which John Austin was the foremost proponent, his ideas becoming posthumously influential in the latter half of the century. The shift from natural law to legal positivism was marked by the devaluing of universal natural law assumptions, which were taken to be principles of morality rather than of law, and an emphasis on the empirical evidence of legal acts executed by sovereign state authorities. In domestic society, only the positive law made by a sovereign state could qualify as proper law. In the field of international law, this definition raised a problem, voiced by Austin himself. In the absence of a globally sovereign state, there could not be, properly speaking, any international law. However, this fundamentalist objection was circumvented by the argument that the body of extant international law consisted of specific acts such as treaties, conventions, agreements, etc., entered into by sovereign states. But who were these sovereign states whose legal transactions with other sovereign states could produce a body of positive international law? The argument was made that the mutual treaties and agreements between these sovereign states were based on certain shared premises and had, over the years, produced a set of mutually recognized and accepted principles of international transaction. In other words, what might otherwise be called customary had been actually incorporated into a body of positive international law because, in fact, those sovereign states constituted an international society, or perhaps a family of nations. In his landmark study on the subject, Charles Alexandrovics has argued that before the 19th century, legal relations between European powers and states in India and Southeast Asia existed on a footing of equality. The former acknowledged the sovereignty of the latter and even adopted, or at least tried to fit into, the legal practices that prevailed in interstate relations in the region. The Europeans were aware that there were different classes of sovereigns in the East, ranging from suzerains such as the Emperor of China or the Mughal Emperor to minor sovereigns who were otherwise vassals of a suzerain, to vassals on the borderline of sovereignty and non-sovereign feudal states. Some of the treaties between Europeans and Indian rulers were declared to be transactions between sovereigns, even when they were only concluded between their local representatives, such as, for instance, the Treaty of 1547 between the kings of Portugal and Vijayanagara. Even when Indian rulers effectively surrendered territory to the East India Company in the 18th century, as in Bengal or the Karnataka or in the Maratha territories, they did so as sovereign powers through treaties. The situation changed drastically in the 19th century, when with the adoption of legal positivism in place of natural law theories, the sovereign states, sovereign status of Eastern rulers came to be doubted, and the family of nations comprising the proper subjects of international law restricted only to the countries of Europe and the new republics of the Americas. Paradoxically, therefore, as Alexandrowicz points out, the domain of the law of nations in the 19th century shrank to regional dimensions, though it still carried the label of universality. While this argument might seem persuasive from a strictly legal point of view, the change in legal regimes makes better sense if one places it, if one places it within the changing political context of relations between European powers and Eastern rulers in the 19th century. The world in the 19th century, as seen from Europe, was quite different from the way it looked in the 18th. The attractions of Asian and later African territories as sources of raw material for European industry, land for European commercial agriculture, and markets for European industrial manufacturers had become overwhelming. Added to this was the expansion through the 19th century of the balance of power system of Europe to include within its scope the territories of virtually the entire globe. The classical balance of power system had developed a mechanism through territorial transfers and shifting alliances to prevent the emergence of a single dominant power or coalition in Europe. Thus, the relative strengths of the core players of the system, Britain, France, Austria, Russia, and Holland, Holland replaced by Prussia after 1815, were frequently adjusted by territorial acquisitions at the expense of minor powers, such as the partitions of Poland in the late 18th century, which is probably the most notorious example, and in the case of the maritime powers, by overseas territories. Overseas territories, in fact, became the chief means for maintaining the European balance in the 19th century, reaching egregious limits in the partition of Africa at the Berlin Colonial Conference of 1884-85. Further, with the rising tide of democratic and nationalist movements in Central and Eastern Europe resonating with the threatening revolutionary rhetoric of the natural rights of peoples and nations to self-government, the discursive shift in the legal domain from natural law to positivism made good conservative sense. This was the political background to the changing significance of the law of nations in the 19th century. The European powers became the only proper subjects of the purportedly universal law of nations because the entire globe was now properly the object of European power. The effect of this change on the Indian subcontinent becomes dramatically clear from a chart prepared by Michael Fisher showing the annexation of territory by the East India Company. Until 1799, the bulk of the territory effectively held by the company, mostly in Bengal and the Carnatic, was not quite annexed since de jure sovereignty still lay with various Indian rulers. With Wellesley's term as Governor General begins a new aggressive policy, not always endorsed by the British government or the company's directors in London, of annexing Indian territory. From 1799 to 1806, in 7 years, the company annexed in Mysore, Awadh, and the Maratha country some 135,000 square miles of land, the size, Fisher points out, of reunited Germany today. Indeed, during Wellesley's period in office, the company annexed some 30,000 square miles of territory every year. Annexations continued through the early 19th century. Lord Hastings, Governor General from 1813 to 23, proclaimed the legal doctrine of paramountcy, by which the authority of the company as the paramount power superseded that of all Indian rulers and bestowed on it the right to annex their territories if, in its view, there were sufficient grounds to do so. From the 1830s, however, despite acknowledging the material benefits of territorial expansion in the form of increased revenue and commerce, the principal justification for annexation became the plea that the people living under various Indian rulers needed to be protected from misgovernment. The consideration that the people wanted and deserved better government, it would be asserted, could trump all prior legal provisions of treaties and override the objections of the rulers whose presumed rights of sovereignty had been superseded by the paramount power assumed by the British. It is here that the history of European territorial acquisitions in Asia and later in the 19th century in Africa would pose conceptual problems for the law of nations. Even though in the course of their imperial advance, European powers such as Britain had entered into various treaties and agreements with Oriental rulers and chieftains, were the latter really to be regarded as sovereign entities? To admit this would be to acknowledge that the family of sovereign nations was the source of international law. That the family of nations that was the source of international law included such non-European members. On the other hand, to deny them any sovereign authority would imply that the treaties they had entered into with the European powers had no legal standing. The problem, as we shall see, dogged imperial policy in India in the 19th century. The solution was devised, once again, by reference to the new comparative scheme of normalization of governmental attributes. It allowed European jurists to make a basic distinction between civilized and uncivilized nations. By virtue of this distinction, the family of nations that constituted the proper subject of international law could be restricted to only the civilized nations of Europe and the white settler nations of the Americas. John Westlake, the doyen of British scholarship on international law in the 19th century, defined this society of states as the Europe that was born in classical Greece and Rome, consolidated at Westphalia, and which now included European and American states, plus, quote, a few Christian nations, such as the Hawaiian Islands, Liberia, and the Orange Free State. As for the uncivilized peoples of the rest of the world, some had no state formations or legal regimes at all, while others had rulers who were arbitrary and whose laws were shaped by religions and cultures that did not value the underlying principles that had produced the law of civilized nations. The uncivilized nations could not be regarded as proper subjects of international law. Westlake, writing at the end of the 19th century, was clear on this point. Sovereignty was a purely European concept, and a native chief in Africa could not be said to have transferred something of which he had no concept. Quote, international law has to treat natives as uncivilized. It regulates for the mutual benefit of the civilized states the claims which they make to sovereignty over the region and leaves the treatment of the natives to the conscience of the state to which sovereignty is awarded. By the 19th century, then, the proper subjects of international law had become restricted to the civilized nations. It was for their mutual benefit that international law was supposed to regulate the transactions between nations. Was this then a shift that had been brought about by a discursive change from universalist natural law doctrines to legal positivism? Marty Koskeniemi, who does not give much credence to the theory of change in legal regimes, argues that appeals to universalist values did not disappear in the 19th century, nor indeed was the universalist humanism of the natural law doctrines of Grotius and Vattel a secular variant of the Christian view of a single God, an impediment to excluding non-European subjects by emphasizing its radical difference according to some purely European standard. Even when non-European nations were regarded as capable of engaging in acts of sovereignty, the proper subjects of the law of nations were always the European states. If there was a change in the discursive practices of law, it took place entirely within a purely European discourse. But the distinction between civilized and uncivilized nations still left unanswered the question of whether treaties entered into by the former with the latter were legally valid. One response was to resort to the flexibility afforded by the normalized scheme of comparison between nations and suggest that there were different degrees of sovereignness among uncivilized states. These degrees translated into different kinds of treaties between European and non-European states, ranging from trade agreements to cession of territory. Each of these transactions implied a certain degree of capacity by the uncivilized state to engage in international transactions. The acquisition of territory by European powers could take place by cession of territory by treaty, or by annexation, or by conquest. There would also emerge in the 19th century the concept of the protectorate, by which a backward state would, through its legal consent, be brought under the control of an imperial power without the latter taking on the burden of administration. Imperial practices in Asia and later Africa thus imparted the quality of variation and complexity to the positivist concept of state sovereignty. This enabled, for instance, in 1856, the inclusion of Ottoman Turkey in an international peace conference, and later in the century, the recognition of Japan, Siam, Persia, and China as occasional members of the family of sovereign nations. Not only that, these imperial practices brought out the conceptual obverse of the idea of sovereignty. It was necessary for an entity, i.e., an uncivilized nation, to first possess sovereignty precisely in order to be able to give it up through a valid legal agreement with a civilized European power. Lasse Oppenheim, writing his canonical text in the early 20th century, revealed some bewilderment when he observed, quote, "Cession of territory made to a member of the family of nations by a state as yet outside that family is real cession and a concern of the law of nations, since such state becomes, through the treaty of cession, in some respects, a member of the family." Anthony Angie correctly concludes, quote, "The development of the idea of sovereignty in relation to the non-European world occurs in terms of dispossession, its ability to alienate its lands and rights." Further, these earlier treaties could not be discarded all of a sudden, not because of any consideration for the sensibilities of Oriental or African rulers, but because of the restraint of legal practice they placed on mutual relations between the European powers. To allow the validity of these treaties to lapse would introduce a dangerous instability into the relations and practices that had been established among the various European powers themselves in Asia and Africa. Angie notes, quote, "It was precisely the fear of disputes over title to colonial territories among European powers that inspired the Conference of Berlin in 1884-85. Consequently, the non-European world had to be located in the positivist system, not merely for purposes of control and suppression, but to prevent its ambiguous status from undermining European solidarity. Not surprisingly, this feature once more confirmed the virtually exclusive centrality of the European powers to the family of nations that made international law in the 19th century." By the middle of the 19th century, the legal concept of the protectorate had emerged so that one state could acquire complete control over another without necessarily assuming the burden of its administration. It was this feature of the protectorate which favored its extensive adoption by European powers in the spread of their dominion. But although control of internal affairs was left to the native ruler, that function could be taken over by the protecting power either because of a provision in the treaty or because the native ruler was incapable of providing good government. The grounds for such intervention were, however, left vague and undefined, affording the paramount power a considerable range of strategic flexibility in framing its policies towards the so-called protected states. Even within the ostensibly positivist framework defined by the concept of undivided sovereignty, the law of nations in the East had to proceed by keeping sovereignty flexible and undefined, and thus subject to policy rather than to fixed legal principle. The history of European imperialism in Asia and Africa thus reveals a general feature of international law itself. It would be said in the latter half of the 20th century that with the rivalry between the two superpowers, the United States and the Soviet Union, in extending their control and dominance over every part of the globe, the field of international law was taken over by policy in place of law. The so-called diplomatic school, which preferred flexible principles and case-by-case negotiated settlements, won over the legal school, which demanded firm principles of law and permanent international institutions of adjudication. The superpowers began to use the language of law to justify their political acts of foreign policy. The history of the law of nations in the Indian subcontinent in the 19th century almost exactly prefigures the history of international law in the second half of the 20th. Until the 18th century, relations between the European powers and Oriental states appear to have largely conformed to the restraints imposed by the concept of sovereignty enshrined in Europe since the Peace of Westphalia in 1648 and theorized in the 18th century by Emeric de Vattel. This was because the European presence in India was either distinctly inferior in terms of power compared to the Indian states, or because, as in the 18th century, they dealt with the Indian states within a certain balance of power framework. The law of nations, as developed in Europe, was quite reasonably suited to such a framework. By the early 19th century, the British power began to be projected in India as a hegemonic power. There was no reason left to abide by the constraints imposed by a law of nations designed to maintain the balance of power. Law was now mobilized to further the policy objectives of the paramount power. Indeed, our discussion of the legal and policy debates over British relations with the Indian states in the 19th century and our survey of the technical instruments they produced for a dominant power to exercise control over other putatively sovereign entities allows us to offer a general definition of modern empire that covers most examples of imperial power in the world in the last two centuries. The imperial prerogative, we could say, lies in the claim to declare the colonial exception. It is, of course, a claim whose effectiveness and legitimacy were open to negotiation. In the 19th century, the principal site where such claims were negotiated and sometimes challenged was that of the so-called family of civilized nations, mainly consisting of the major European powers. In a related sense, the claim also had to be negotiated with domestic political formations in the imperial countries. Only in a peripheral and utterly subsidiary sense were they negotiated with the people of subordinated states. Besides the privilege of declaring the colonial exception, here applies to relations between a sovereign power and other political entities whose sovereignty has to be recognized even if only for them to surrender that sovereignty, whether wholly or partially. There are, of course, a variety of techniques that are developed but all involve a determination that the universal principles that apply to relations between sovereign states cannot apply in this exceptional case because, for one reason or another, the entity does not deserve the full status of or has lost its legitimacy as a proper sovereign state. This is the definition of modern empire that emerges from its history over the last 200 years. I turn now to the story of the annexation of Awadh in 1856. We will see how exactly empire's law was made to replace the law of nations in the Indian subcontinent in the 19th century. Carl Schmitt, who railed against the supersession after World War II of the public international law of Europe by the claims of both the United States and the Soviet Union to wage war on behalf of humanity, would not have flinched if he heard our story, since he did not believe that the Indian states were ever the proper subjects of the law of nations. It was legitimate and rational, he would have said, for the stability of the European state system that Britain should bring under its domain the control of that part of the world. But in order not to succumb to nationalist sentiments of outrage or nostalgia, we should also remind ourselves that the effective erasure in the 19th century under British imperial auspices of the law of nations from the territorial space of the Indian subcontinent was an essential step for the imagining of undivided national sovereignty in the 20th. Indeed, the second half of the 19th century was when, as Manu Goswami has shown, the territory of subcontinental India, including the princely states, now effectively consolidated under British paramountcy, began to be geographically imagined as a national space, with a map, with borders, and with physical and human resources that could be claimed for economic and political assertion by an Indian nation. When in 1947, Vallabhbhai Patel, the Home Minister of newly independent India, proceeded to cajole and sometimes coerce the hundreds of Indian princes, hitherto under the protection of the British, to integrate their territories with those of the Indian state through treaties of accession, his acts were, from the formal point of view of the law of nations, no less imperialist. But such, invariably, is the tangled story of the sovereignty of most modern nations on earth. Dalhousie and paramountcy. By the 1840s, even the directors of the East India Company in London were persuaded that its territorial reach in India should be extended in order to better consolidate and expand British interests in the region. By then, the colonial economy of India was taking its characteristic shape under conditions of rapid industrial growth in Britain. Private European entrepreneurs were seeking opportunities for profit-making in the frontier zones outside the relatively regulated domains of the company's territories. The company's interests, too, were now actively engaged further east as far as China, where armed conflict broke out in 1839-42 over the British trade there in Indian opium. Besides, the security of the company's possessions became a concern with growing fears of Russian dominance along the northern frontier. British officials in India, looking to expand the company's lands, were now much more likely than before to receive the approval of their directors in London. Dalhousie is famous in British Indian history for achieving the largest territorial expansion under a single Governor General. Between 1848 and 56, he annexed, as Michael Fisher reminds us, 250,000 square miles, representing a quarter of the company's entire lands in India and clocking an annual rate of 85,000 square kilometers, which was equivalent to acquiring an Austria every year. And yet, reading the records of the period, the post-colonial historian is likely to be somewhat perplexed by the endless debates over legal jurisdiction, treaty obligations, internal sovereignty, etc., that dominate colonial decision-making under Dalhousie. If it was true, as the first generation of nationalist historians of the 1950s concluded, that the princes of India in the 19th century wore the regalia of statehood only at the sufferance of the British, and that their presumption of sovereignty were no more than an empty shell, then why were the annexations of Dalhousie so contentious? It is one of the perennial dangers of treating history as the ineluctable path to the decisive construction of the present that we overlook the real constraints and possibilities that made the mid-19th century juncture a moment of critical historical transition in India. Unless we tune ourselves to the discursive shifts that took place in international law and diplomacy in the 19th century, we would never discover what the fuss was all about. The received orthodoxy among colonial officials in the 1840s was non-interference in the internal sovereignty of the Indian states. Dalhousie, however, was keen to find room even within those constraints to expand the company's territories. He found it in the so-called doctrine of lapse. The first test case came early in his term of office in the western Indian state of Satara in 1848, where the ruler died without leaving behind a son. Dalhousie annexed the state and defended his action by a logic that was purely strategic. Quote, "I cannot conceive it possible for anyone to dispute the policy of taking advantage of every just opportunity that presents itself for consolidating the territories that already belong to us by taking possession of states which may lapse in the midst of them. By incorporating Satara with our possessions, we should acquire continuity of military communication and increase the revenues of the state." He would repeat the argument in 1853 when he annexed Nagpur by applying the doctrine of lapse. In 1849, he annexed Punjab on the ground of disloyalty, since the Sikh chieftains had allegedly sought the assistance of the Afghans in resisting the paramountcy of the British. However, even as he was possessed by a radical imperial vision, Dalhousie was mindful of the legal constraints that he needed to respect. The absence of natural heirs he regarded as a strategic opportunity. Disloyalty was surely an offense that had to be punished by the paramount power, even though such a thing was unknown in international law. But he balked at intervention in internal sovereignty. The test case was presented in 1851 when the clamor was raised in official circles for annexing Hyderabad for the alleged misrule of the Nizam. Dalhousie resisted, and I'm quoting from him, "The acknowledged superiority of the British power in India entitles it to interfere in the administration of the native princes if their administration tends unquestionably to the injury of the subjects and of the allies of the British government. But I recognize no mission confided to the British government which imposes upon it the obligation or can confer upon it the right of deciding authoritatively on the existence of native independent sovereignties or of arbitrarily setting them aside whenever their administration may not accord with its own views." Dalhousie, it seems, was particularly sensitive to public opinion in Britain and was wary of doing something that might be construed there as having violated international obligations and good faith. Edwin Arnold, the celebrated narrator of the life of the Buddha, was paradoxically also the biographer of Dalhousie. He writes, quote, "The passion for approval and consent visible in his last anxious act was conspicuous at every stage of his career, and sprang from something deeper than vanity in one who had witnessed the omnipotence of the popular will preparing in 1848 to shake the powers on earth." Dalhousie was also reminded by friends and advisors from Britain of the need to keep British public opinion in mind before embarking on bold imperial initiatives. The annexation of Awadh would test the political skills and legendary fortitude of Dalhousie to their limits. Awadh under British protection. Awadh at the end of the 18th century was a kingdom comprising the greater part of the Gangetic Plains, roughly equal in size to and possibly greater in population than Great Britain. It had emerged as an independent principality through the 18th century with the decline of the Mughal Empire. In the second half of the century, as the British power rose in Bengal and expanded to the frontiers of Awadh in the north, the ruling Nawabs were forced into various treaties with the British that allowed the East India Company special privileges in matters of trade and recruitment of soldiers to its army. But the internal sovereignty of Awadh was protected. In 1775, when Nawab Shuja-ud-Dawlah died, the British claimed new privileges. Assuming with calculated cynicism, as Michael Edwards described the move, that the death of the Nawab canceled the agreements entered into with him, the Calcutta Council insisted on negotiating a fresh treaty with his successor. By it, the Nawab became a puppet in the hands of the Governor General and the state of Awadh, a dependency of the East India Company. From this time, a British resident was appointed to the court of Awadh to represent the supervisory authority of the company. Awadh also became a substantial supplier of raw cotton, textiles, indigo, and opium to British Bengal. In 1801, Awadh was partitioned and large parts of its territory were ceded to the company. Arthur Wellesley, later to be celebrated in world history as the Duke of Wellington, defended the actions of his brother Richard Wellesley, the viceroy, in the following words. I'm quoting from Arthur Wellesley. For some years previous to 1798, apprehensions had been entertained that Zaman Shah, the king of Kabul, would carry into execution an old and favorite plan of the Afghan government to invade Hindustan. Towards the close of the year 1799, the Governor General called upon the Nawab of Awadh to dismiss his expensive, useless, and dangerous troops and to fill their places by increased numbers of the company's troops. When he said he was unable to meet the financial burden, a treaty was concluded by which, in commutation of the subsidy and for the perpetual defense of his country, the Nawab ceded to the company the territories of about approximately half of his kingdom. Military man that he was, Wellington put the imperial argument in the most matter-of-fact terms possible. The partial annexation of Awadh in 1801 was made necessary by the needs of security. 200 years ago, it was still Afghanistan. Restoration of order, deployment of troops, and resources to pay for it all. There was no argument here of coming to the rescue of the oppressed people. In the early decades of the 19th century, Awadh was practically governed by a dual authority. The Nawab's administration was crippled by the constant interference of the British resident. Most historians agree that under this system of meddling, the Nawab and his ministers were left with little initiative or responsibility. A corrupt administration was guaranteed by the presence of the company's troops. It was later alleged that the Awadh rulers stopped ruling and retired into the life of wine, women, and poetry. However, Thomas Metcalfe writes, indolence was the only appropriate response to the situation in which the princes of Awadh were placed, in which they could not be overthrown, but could not act effectively in either the old way or the new. But there was never any question about the loyalty of the Awadh rulers to the British. In 1819, the British decided to upgrade the status of the Awadh ruler from that of a nominal subordinate of the emperor in Delhi to that of a sovereign king, thereby diminishing even further the already marginal authority of the Mughal throne. The coronation was held in Lucknow, the capital city of Awadh, accompanied by a 21-gun salute and God Save the King. Regardless of this legal fantasy, however, the British hardly took the trappings of Awadh royalty seriously. Their officers insisted on sitting rather than standing in the royal presence. They would move around the city in palanquins and have umbrellas held over them, both considered privileges of the local aristocracy. When the Governor General Lord Hardinge visited Lucknow in 1847, the King of Awadh was made to wear English patent leather boots to establish parity of status, instead of following the local tradition of visitors removing their shoes when in the presence of the king. As we have mentioned before, the prudent view until the 1840s in British circles was not to interfere in the internal affairs of the subsidiary Indian allies, because that was both the letter and the spirit of the treaties that the British had signed with them, and also because constant interference tended to sour relations without bringing any permanent benefits. But the policy of non-interference also made the British presence in those dependencies utterly anomalous. British officers complained that the company's troops were being asked to protect a corrupt and oppressive native administration. Indeed, the British power was becoming an accomplice in the perpetuation of countless crimes and immoralities. This view of the imperial mission was voiced with great fervor by the liberal and evangelical movement. The evangelicals in the 1840s had two main items on their agenda for the Indian Empire: the spread of English education among Indians and the further opening of India to Christian missionaries. They had powerful proponents within the company establishment in officials like Charles Grant. In their minds, the duties of evangelical Christianity were wonderfully married in a blissful ménage à trois to thriving commerce as well as progressive social reform. As Grant put it, quote, "In considering the affairs of the world as under the control of the supreme disposer and those distant territories providentially put into our hands, is it not necessary to conclude that they were given to us not merely that we might draw an annual profit from them, but that we might diffuse among their inhabitants, long sunk in darkness, vice, and misery, the light and benign influence of the truth, the blessings of well-regulated society, the improvements and comforts of active industry. In every progressive step of this work, we shall also serve the original design with which we visited India, that design still so important to this country, the extension of our commerce." The evangelical tone was particularly shrill among the non-official British population of India, among merchants, missionaries, and newspaper editors. They were obsessively focused on the dissolute lifestyles of Indian princes. It was virtually axiomatic for them that the Indian nobility was immoral and incapable of good government. Charles Jackson, a defender of Dalhousie's policies, wrote, quote, "But what hope could be entertained of any Indian prince brought up in the purple, of his becoming anything but an indolent, sensual, and tyrannical sovereign?" Then, citing a report on the last ruler of Nagpur, he continues, "A distaste for business and low habits seem the distinguishing features of his temperament. His natural inclination has led him, when unchecked, to absorb himself in the society of low followers, in the sports of wrestling, kite flying, and cards, in singing and dancing, and in the intercourse of his dancing girls. A concubine by the name Jani is spoken of as having led the Raja into confirmed habits of drinking about 8 years since, so that now, when not ill, his drinking exceeds a bottle of brandy a day." Edwin Arnold wrote, quote, "It has no great bearing indeed on our right to annex Awadh that their kings took their pleasure in the stud yard and pandered at once to the passions of he-goats and their own, or that they laid aside the scepter to catch cats. The brazen circularity created by these assumptions and prejudices is best exemplified by Henry Eliot's methodological preface to his immensely influential compendium of extracts from the chronicles of Muslim rule in India." I'm quoting from Eliot. In Indian histories, there is little which enables us to penetrate below the glittering surface and observe the practical operation of a despotic government. If, however, we turn our eyes to the present Mohammedan kingdoms of India and examining the character of the princes, we may fairly draw a parallel between ancient and modern times. We behold kings, even of our own creation, slunk in sloth and debauchery, and emulating the vices of a Caligula or a Commodus. In 1850, the Delhi Gazette put the following challenge to the government, quote, "What we contend for is that our countrymen should either govern Oudh or abandon its rulers to their fate. As it is, we are powerless for good and unwilling accomplices in evil. We do infinite and perpetual wrong because some of our nation in times past made treaties which it is immoral to observe." There was little doubt in British opinion in India about the superiority of British rule, but there was a serious debate in the middle of the 19th century about the legality as well as the morality of the annexation of Indian kingdoms. Henry Lawrence, for instance, an imperial hero of the first rank, was what could be defined as a fundamentalist Christian, but he was firmly against annexations. In an anonymous article in the Calcutta Review in 1845, he wrote, quote, "Let the government of the country be taken over, but let the administration of the country be as far as possible native. Let not a rupee come into the company's coffers. Let Oudh at last be governed, not for one man, the king, but for him and his people." The road to annexation. In 1847, Wajid Ali Shah became king of Oudh. He was an accomplished poet in Urdu and Persian. His intelligence, aesthetic sensibility, and wit were much admired by the sophisticated elite of Lucknow. Curiously, Dalhousie became Governor General of India in the same year. One cannot think of a starker contrast between two characters in the same play. Dalhousie was a fervent Presbyterian and is said to have carried self-discipline to the point of self-mortification. He was haughty, imperious, autocratic, and quick-tempered, resented opposition, and demanded absolute obedience. His industry and devotion to work was legendary. He was also thoroughly convinced of the superiority of British rule over that of any of the Indian rulers. An admiring biographer described Dalhousie's attitude in the following words, I'm quoting, "He knew too much of the native princes and courts of his day to cultivate their goodwill at the expense of their ungoverned subjects. His sympathies went with the suffering people, not with their weak, vicious, idle, pleasure-loving masters. Policy and justice alike impelled him to give the former a fair chance, wherever possible, of bettering their lot by a change from native to British rule." But Dalhousie was careful to pick his way skillfully through the thicket of laws and conventions. In 1849, he appointed Colonel William Sleeman as resident in Oudh with the express instruction to provide him with a detailed report on the state of administration in the kingdom. Sleeman was already a much decorated officer who had made his mark by suppressing thuggee, the depredations of fearsome gangs of armed robbers all over northern India. With his Puritan sensibilities, he detested the court of Lucknow. Quote, "Such a scene of intrigue, corruption, depravity, neglect of duty, and abuse of authority I have never before been placed in and hope never again to undergo. Lucknow is an overgrown city surrounding an overgrown court which has for the last half century exhausted all the resources of this fine country." Dalhousie, in the meantime, had made up his mind that Oudh must be brought under the direct management of the company, although he was still opposed to outright annexation. Sleeman's report was a total indictment of the administration of Oudh, and in particular of its ruler, Wajid Ali, who he described as, quote, "a crazy imbecile in the hands of a few fiddlers, eunuchs, and poets." Later published in two volumes, Sleeman's diary takes one through the different districts of Oudh and details stories of rampant crime, bribery, extortion, fraud, infanticide, sati, insecurity of life and property, a predatory army, and an unresponsive government. He declared, quote, that the king's ambition seems to be limited to the reputation of being the best drum beater, dancer, and poet of the day. He is utterly unfit to reign. He strongly recommended that the administration of Awadh be taken over by the East India Company, but he added a warning. Were we to take advantage of the occasion to annex or confiscate Awadh or any part of it, our good name in India would invariably suffer, and that good name is more valuable to us than a dozen of Awadhs. We are now looked up throughout India as the only impartial arbitrators that the people generally have ever had or can ever hope to have without us. And from the time we cease to be so looked up to, we must begin to sink. In Awadh, the giant's strength is manifest, and we cannot use it like a giant without suffering in the estimation of all India. We must show ourselves to be high-minded. Sleeman was both optimistic and confident that the people of Awadh would welcome British administration with open arms. Quote, there is not, I believe, another government in India so entirely opposed to the best interest and most earnest wishes of the people as that of Awadh now is. At least, I have never seen or read of one. People of all classes have become utterly weary of it. All from the highest to the lowest would at this time hail the advent of our administration with joy. And the rest of India, to whom Awadh misrule is well known, would acquiesce in the conviction that it had become imperative for the protection of the people. As it happened, before Dalhousie could do anything with Sleeman's report, there were troubles in Burma, recently conquered and annexed by the British, and it was not until the end of 1854, when the Burmese wars ended, that he could turn his attention again to Awadh. By then, Sleeman had left Lucknow because of bad health and probably unendurable moral outrage, and Dalhousie now sent another Scotsman, Colonel Outram, to Lucknow to give him an updated report. Outram knew nothing of northern India and did not have even a smattering of Persian, the language in which all official work was carried out in Awadh. He did the best he could. He simply recycled Sleeman's report. In substance, its substance was as follows. The king was guided by low and incapable advisors, eunuchs, fiddlers, and songsters. The treasury was exhausted, and the troops and establishments were in arrears. The courts were notoriously venal. Justice is openly bought and sold. All subordinate judges are equally and notoriously corrupt. The frontier police was the only efficient police administration, but that was because it was commanded by British officers. The Awadh army, by contrast, presented an appalling picture. No new roads had been built since Sleeman's report of 1849. But, noted Outram, while public works of utility are so scant throughout Awadh, the capital itself boasts of a greater display of palaces and tombs than any other city in India. Vast sums are lavished on His Majesty's new palaces, gorgeous and extensive as they are. He finished his report with some long tables listing all crimes reported in the districts of Awadh between 1848 and 1854, and inferred, without any statistical justification, that they were on the increase. He concluded, quote, the condition of Awadh is, as I have shown, most deplorable, and it has been my painful duty to demonstrate that the lamentable condition of the kingdom has been caused by the very culpable apathy and gross misrule of the sovereign and his darbar. It is therefore peculiarly distressing to me to find that in continuing to uphold the sovereign power of this effete and incapable dynasty, we do so at the cost of 5 million of people on whose behalf we are bound to secure such a system of government as shall be conducive to their prosperity and calculated to secure to them their lives and property. But he also anticipated a possible question. It may be naturally supposed that the people of Awadh, if so greatly oppressed as has been represented, would emigrate to the neighboring British districts, which it does not appear from the replies I have yet received from the magistrates. But the condition of the people of Awadh cannot fairly be tested by the extent of emigration, for although shamefully oppressed, they are much attached to their country. One more piece of evidence, we might note, of the moral infancy of the people of India. In June 1855, Dalhousie prepared a memorandum declaring the government of Awadh has been notorious for its abuse of power, for gross misrule, and for the oppression of its subjects. But his advice was cautious. I, for my part, do not advise that the province of Awadh should be declared to be British territory. Instead, he recommended that the King of Awadh should be required to vest the exclusive administration of the civil and military government of Awadh and its dependencies in the hands of the company. But for this, the Governor General says, the King's consent is indispensable. It would not be expedient or right to endeavor to extract this consent by means of menace or compulsion. The contorted logic was patently obvious. The King would be required to give up the administration, but only by his consent. In other words, he was being asked to affirm his sovereignty by voluntarily giving it up. Dalhousie was clearly thinking of critics in Parliament and the public, because he added, quote, the measure, if it be assented to, will doubtless be assailed by those who are ever on the watch to attack the policy of the Indian government. He had been warned of this by the president of the board of directors of the company. Any plan which approaches to annexation of Awadh will, I have reason to believe, excite a violent opposition from some active parties in this country. Hence, a show had to be made for the sanctity of treaty obligations. Awadh annexed. But Dalhousie still had to convince the members of his own council. The weakness of his argument was pointed out by John Peter Grant. On comparing the two plans, it will be found that they differ only in this, that the first plan, annexation, involves no political fiction, while the second plan, the King's consent, does involve one. Grant made no secret of his understanding of the moral issues involved in this matter. I have always thought our long neglect of our obligations towards the people of Awadh a great moral error. No one, I believe, maintains that a policy of permanent non-interference would be justifiable. Doran, another council member, asserted bluntly that the paramount power had an unlimited right of interference, irrespective of treaties, if it wanted to put an end to the oppression of native princes. As many as four members of the Governor General's Council disagreed with Dalhousie's consent option and favored outright annexation of Awadh. In the meantime, public voices emphasizing the moral duties of empire were reaching a crescendo. The Lucknow correspondent of the Englishman wrote, quote, every day that the annexation of this misgoverned country is delayed, another day of suffering is added to the lot of hundreds, nay thousands, of one of the finest races in Hindustan. An anonymous article in the Calcutta Review by a European visitor to Lucknow was almost apoplectic with rage. Quote, we saw a great deal, but I'm sick of all this. I have been listening all day to stories, some of them backed by irrefutable evidence, any one of which would make the House of Commons quiver with indignation. What is the misgovernment of Naples compared with this? I doubt if Tiberius or Caligula were a bit worse, either in cruelty or debauchery, than the Nasiruddin. And the present man is as bad, though of a feebler energy. Why is not indigo grown, said I. Well, said he, a man of Lucknow, it has been tried. Two Englishmen tried it. One was murdered, and the other had to fly. You see, there is no security of life and property here. I heard, too, one little statistical fact that will give you some idea of the state of morals. There are upwards of 100 houses in Lucknow, all taxed and registered, and inhabited not by women, but by men. Was Gomorrah worse? Such is life in Lucknow. Surrounded by this clamor, the Court of Directors in Lucknow wrote to the Council in Calcutta to say that unless it was a virtual certainty that the King would accede to the transfer of his administration, he should not be offered any alternative and Awadh should be annexed by force if necessary. Goaded by his superiors and faced with a timetable by which he was to relinquish his post and return to Britain by March, Dalhousie was forced to throw legal caution to the winds. He decided to offer the King of Awadh a new treaty by which he would sign away his kingdom or face removal by force. Even though he had changed his earlier position, Dalhousie had no qualms about what he was doing. On February 4th, 1856, with British troops from Kanpur advancing to the gates of Lucknow, Major General Outram met Wajid Ali Shah. According to the official report, His Majesty turned towards the resident and said, "Why have I deserved this? What have I committed?" When the resident explained the options, the King, quote, gave vent to his feelings in a passionate burst of grief and exclaimed, "Treaties are necessary between equals only. Who am I now that the British government should enter into treaties with?" Uncovering himself, he placed his turban in the hands of the resident, declaring that now his titles, rank, and position were all gone. It was not for him to sign a treaty or to enter into any negotiation. The resident assured His Majesty that at the expiration of 3 days, unless His Majesty acceded to the wishes of the British government, the resident would have no alternative but to assume the government of the country. On February 7th, Outram sent a message to Calcutta announcing that the King had declined to execute the treaty. That day, British troops entered Lucknow as Outram issued a proclamation announcing the removal of the King and the assumption of power by the East India Company. A few days later, Wajid Ali, along with his family and servants, was transported to Calcutta to spend the rest of his life there as a virtual prisoner. In his trail came a song that would for some time be remembered and sung in musical soirees among Calcutta's Bengali elite. "The traitors have so unsettled the kingdom that His Highness has to go to London. In every house the women weep, the pavestones weep on every street." Dalhousie put it on record that he had been prompted by the opinion of the Court of Directors in London and of members of his own council in Calcutta to abandon his previous position and adopt the more peremptory course. Privately, he wrote, "So our gracious Queen has 5 million more subjects and £1,300,000 more revenue than she had yesterday. As a present object, it would have been better that the treaty had been signed, for an amicable agreement would have looked best. But as regards the future, it is much better as it is. We shall have to bear a much less heavy charge, and we are entirely free prospectively." Barely a year after the annexation of Awadh, most of northern India would be set ablaze in 1857 by a massive popular uprising that nearly brought down the British Indian Empire. Following the violent suppression of that revolt, British policy would carefully stay away from further annexation of Indian states, preferring instead a more conservative policy of resting its power on local chiefs, landlords, and the so-called martial races. Not until the late 19th century would a new liberal pedagogy of culture be launched, seeking to introduce in small doses the institutions of limited representative government. But by then, a new and articulate politics of Indian nationalism began to transform the political terrain of empire. What is remarkable is how many of the same arguments, including the evangelical fervor, the axiomatic assumption of the mantle of civilization, the fig leaf of legalism, the intelligence reports, the forgeries and subterfuges, and the hard-headed calculations of national interest remain exactly the same at the beginning of the 21st century. The global techniques of empire honed in the days of British paramountcy in India continue to shape the practices of empire today. Indeed, an entire set of global practices, ranging from equal sovereignty of nation states and non-interference in their internal affairs to claims of paramountcy, are visible today, all of them techniques developed in imperial theaters in the 19th century. The formula democracy at home, despotism abroad is perfectly applicable now in the context of realist discourses of national interest, the liberal evangelical creed of using force to enforce human rights and accept the responsibility to protect oppressed populations is still a potent ideological drive. Hence, the instrumental use of that ideological rhetoric for realist imperialist ends is entirely available, as one has seen numerous times since the invasion of Iraq in 2003. Thank you very much.
We'll have some questions now.
How many mics are there?
Thank you. Yes. Please say who you are.
Richard Tuck.
Yes.
Department of Government in Harvard. Thank you. Very fascinating, very convincing. I have one question about the degree to which this is unique to the colonial empires. Because what you described about the way that the British handled the native princes is not so unlike the way Bismarck handled the princes in Germany during the process of unification. I mean, there's a sort of common theme here for paramount states dealing with subordinate states in this way, almost irrespective of the ethnic or the colonial status. It seems to be a more general phenomena than merely found in what we think of now as the empires. Though, of course, Germany is called an empire. It's got an emperor. Yeah. So I wondered if you could say something about that.
You see, I think there is a clear difference between Prussia as a paramount power in relation to other German states and Britain as one in relation to Indian states, largely because if you think of the genealogy of the sort of legal apparatus within which this functions, then obviously there's a huge difference, which is what I was suggesting, that in the, let's say, even in the 18th century, when Britain is, or France, you know, or other European powers, begin to acquire territories in the East, they do so by accepting the local legal framework, which is completely different from the legal framework of the law of nations as it had already been developed in Europe. Whereas in the case of Prussia in relation to the other states, it's within that same, broadly speaking, legal discursive framework.
Well, that was really what I was asking about, whether mm-hmm. that's actually true, or whether there's a similar shift from the formal legal structures mm-hmm. to a manipulative and semi-legal.
So that is completely.
That seems to be common between both Europe and India.
True.
This time.
See, that is true, and that's very often attributed to this shift from sort of natural law doctrines to positivism, which I've suggested is the same here.
Yes. Here, please.
Just wondering, Diana Sorensen in Faculty of Arts and Sciences, and wondering in this genealogy that looks from Europe east, what would change if you looked from Europe west, where it seems the law of nations is given a very different inflection, obviously, in the earlier empires, the Spanish, for instance.
Well, that's a topic on which a great deal has been written, including Richard here. One very crucial difference, it seems to me, between that earlier phase of European empires outside Europe and what begins to happen from the 18th century in the East is that broadly speaking, even though there are various sort of legal concepts that are applied and debated, largely, almost entirely, among Europeans. I mean, for instance, the debates between the scholastics and the humanists in Spain, for instance, over the legitimacy of the conquests of the Americas. There is never a reason to think that the institutions of law and government and property of the Native Americans must somehow be accommodated within the legal frameworks that would be developed. You see, this was almost never a serious question. Whereas this is something that becomes unavoidable in the East. Because, in fact, from the very beginning, it's clear that local elites have to be incorporated into the new colonial apparatus. And the way to do it would be not necessarily to simply start from a clean slate. You could not do it. So therefore, the entire problems of how law is to be interpreted or developed in the East becomes one of trying to reconcile the legal frameworks and conceptions that prevail and practices that prevail in those countries and somehow make them intelligible and acceptable in terms of the principles of European law. You see, and this is where most of this problem emerges. For instance, all of these arguments about quasi-sovereigns, having to concede sovereignty simply in order to establish the legality of a particular agreement or treaty, right? Even though it is completely understood, sometimes in flatly cynical ways, that this is entirely dictated by policy. It's got nothing to do with law or legal principles. But the legal principles have to be kept in place, right? Primarily, the two reasons that I've suggested. One, relations among the European powers, which have a certain legal framework in order to make those relations stable. And secondly, the need to justify actions to a domestic political opinion, where again, this becomes important.
Brother, can I ask you, in the book and in your speech here today, you draw an analogy, in a way, mm-hmm. between that earlier period mm-hmm. and the current post 9/11. Mm. Could you care to reflect on legal because there is, of course, an analogy, but the legal institutions and instrumentalities have all changed in a way. They're out. So could you comment on that, on now what in this context, in the current context, in the current political context, what is being violated in the legal system and what the paradoxes and ambivalences are, because that's, as I see it, the one of the things that you've most interestingly shown are the internal contradictions and the paradoxes that take place, both in terms of governmentality and in terms of normalization. So what do you think at that level is happening now within the legal apparatus and its political interpretations and its distributions of power?
Yes. To answer that question briefly, because in a sense this is a very large subject. To answer it very briefly, I would say this, that there is a period from the end of World War II to the end of the Cold War. This is to say the Cold War period, in which period it's generally agreed that, in fact, policy overtakes considerations of law, that international law, in fact, becomes subordinate to what are essentially foreign policy requirements of the two great powers, which basically decide, for instance, what happens in the United Nations or something like that. You know, the Security Council, for instance, is completely subordinated to the dictates of Cold War politics. Now, since the end of the Cold War, the collapse of the Soviet Union, etc., there is clearly a resurgence in the idea of international law as containing a set of legal principles that are that have value in themselves and that need to be asserted. And if wherever possible, in fact, implemented. This is where I think the imperial, the history of past empires becomes interesting. Because one of the things I was suggesting is first, in this story of the transition from a period where there is recognition of equal sovereignties of different powers to a period of British hegemony, where in fact law is completely subordinated to considerations of policy. In a sense, you could argue this is precisely the sense of what happens from the 1950s to the late 1980s. And that's a period where, in fact, as far as law is concerned, right, how does one regard the status of different agreements, treaties, et cetera, with all kinds of powers, where at one level, after World War II, you have a world in which, in the formal sense, all nation states have equal sovereignty. Because they're all, let's say, they're all equally members of the General Assembly of the United Nations, where each one has a single vote. So that's the formal status. But then you clearly have a whole range of practices which operate on the understanding that all states are not equally sovereign. Right? And that, I'm suggesting, is, the techniques for that are precisely, they have already been developed in the period of the 19th century empires, right?
So it's the same process of normalization.
It must operate through normalization.
Right.
Now what I'm suggesting is even the techniques, even the specific techniques, such as things like protectorates, such as things like, separate treaties where particular states are required to concede certain kinds of, as it were, attributes of sovereignty to superior powers, right? And even none of that is permanent. They can change. Treaties can be revised. All of those kinds of things. All the techniques have already been there. What's changed again now, since the 1990s, and this, I think, is the period where, I don't have a clear answer of is there a new pattern altogether, because it seems to me there is clearly an attempt to reassert a space for law in the international domain to find an autonomous place, right? But there, the crucial questions every time is, and very often the charge is made, that in fact law is applied precisely to states, which are somehow less than fully sovereign, and that the really big powers can never be brought under the supervision of the laws. And sometimes even formally the United States refuses to acknowledge, let's say, the status of the international court. So that's the interesting question here. Where does this lead? And I don't necessarily have an answer, but this is where I think it seems to me this this tussle between law on the one side and policy on the other is clearly being fought out at this moment.
One other issue that I just would like to raise and then is the difference in the nature of
there
security.
There was some other question. Okay.
It's security.
Yeah.
And whether that paradigm is shifted.
Yeah.
Hi, I just wanted to comment on that last point you made, maybe ask a question or how you would think about this. But one of the things you're assuming is the stability of the unit of the state when you're talking about this inequality.
Yes.
But if we go back, the question becomes, what is a state? Who gets to have a state? And how these formations are actually changing, especially since the 90s.
Yeah. You see, one of the things that's very much a part of the idea of the normalized state, right, is that the ranking of states or the grading of states in relation to some norm is always subject to change. In other words, even if you were to take this as an attribute of some degree of sovereignness, and you were to say, well, there is some norm of sovereignness, and some states reach that norm, others don't quite reach that norm. But that's not a permanent attribute. You see, it's subject to change. You know, states can become, as it were, more sovereign over time or less sovereign over time. So all of this is perfectly, you know, it's one within this framework, it's perfectly possible to comprehend the sort of questions you're raising. So that in itself is not quite a conceptual problem, it would seem to me.
The temporal scope of your book extends from 1756 all the way to 1940, at least. And then, of course, you talk about an epilogue that comes all the way to the present. But when you extract from the book, as you did today, and you made an argument about the law of nations in the first half of your lecture, and then tried to illustrate that argument with a historical narrative about the annexation of Awadh. In some ways, you know, that sounded very different to me from what I got from the book as a whole. And that's why I wanted you to reflect a little bit on, you know, the period just after 1856, 1857. And I say this because, well, the law of nations or international law acquires a certain degree of stability precisely in that period, the 1860s decade. And that's also seen by global historians and historians of Europe, certainly, such as my friend and colleague Charlie Mayer, as the beginning of an age of territoriality. And so what happens in this period from roughly 1860 onwards up to the First World War, and I want you to just reflect on it, that there is a law of nations, and I'm trying to go back to the title of your lecture, international law and the pedagogy of violence. International law seems to impart a certain degree of stability, or at least a certain phase of a lack of war in Europe after the Franco-Prussian Wars are over, after the 1866 to 70 period. And from 1870 until the outbreak of the Balkan Wars on the eve of the First World War, you know, European balance of power has a certain amount of stability. But look at what happens in the rest of the world. You have the scramble over Africa between 1870 and the First World War, and you made reference to the 1884-85 quote-unquote treaty. But in India, what happens, of course, is that, as you pointed out, by 1856, thanks to Wellesley in the beginning of the 19th century and Dalhousie between 1848 and 56, two-thirds of the landmass of the Indian subcontinent is already under colonial rule. And so maybe, you know, this aspect of indirect rule treaties with princes becomes less salient at that point. And of course, Queen Victoria declares in 1858 that henceforth all treaties with princes will be respected. But the princes become far more subservient under Crown Raj than they ever were under Company Raj. And what becomes more significant is, in fact, the construction of a centralized colonial state with a unitary ideology of sovereignty, Queen Victoria being declared Queen Empress, but also, you know, for the benefit of her Indian subjects, she's called Kaisare Hind. So I just want you to talk a little bit about, you know, what you see as the connection between international law and the Pedagogy of Violence in what is a fascinating period of the aftermath of the annexation of Awadh, the Great Rebellion of 1857. That period, I think, is quite a fascinating one that stretches from roughly 1860 to the outbreak of the First World War.
Right. Well, first, looking at India in particular, the British Indian Empire, after 1858, there are no more annexations. I mean, this policy of annexation is stopped.
There is one other, which is Burma. And
yes, exactly.
There are similar arguments, and Randolph Churchill says in the manner of Dalhousie that he's going to make a New Year's gift on the 1st of January 1886
The only areas are precisely the frontiers. There's Burma and there's Afghanistan, which remember...
which is failed attempts.
But within the space of the what's seen to be the domain of paramountcy, where there are already treaties with various Indian princes, the tendency that you had earlier, which is to use various legal ruses, et cetera, to annex territory, because direct administration was seen to be, purely in policy terms, more convenient, more efficient, and more productive of British resources and the expansion of British economic interests, particularly. But this is given up after 1858. What, in fact, happens is very interestingly on the question of indirect rule, etc. Indirect rule is then developed into a fairly elaborate theoretical apparatus where the argument is that the imperial presence need only be a very thin presence on top, which is essentially a kind of paramount sovereignty. But actual internal sovereignty can be allowed to local chiefs, rulers, and so on, which is worked out elaborately. And, second half of the 19th century is precisely the period when, for instance, people like Lee Warner and so on in India, and later on, this is clearly developed by people like Lugard in Africa. These are all building up from the Indian examples that indirect rule is an equally efficient and less expensive form of colonial administration. And this is precisely what happens in Africa. There's very little attempt to do the kind of thoroughgoing colonial administration that one saw in India. It doesn't happen in Africa. So, and that's where, again, the idea of protector, this is explicitly, it's a category of international law that in fact appears very largely in relation to a whole range of African territories where this becomes. Now, the interesting question about what happens in this period of international law, 1860s to 1914, right? Where you could argue, yes, there is international law still functions, as I was arguing, essentially as an apparatus of regulating relations between European powers. That's principally its function. It was extended in this period to include practically the entire world, where European possessions of different kinds, territorial and others, are defined legally and, as it were, signed and sealed in various conferences and treaties and so on among the European powers, right? But it is clearly reaching a crisis. It's reaching a crisis precisely because this is what's leading up to World War I, where new powers like Germany, like Japan and the United States in the Pacific, are claiming essentially imperial possessions, and there is no space anymore, right? And this is where you get World War I, and then you get that entire edifice of the old empires basically collapsing. I could talk about the League period, which I think is very interesting, precisely if you think of it in terms of the continuation of many of these categories into the period of the League, because what then emerges is an attempt to regulate through an international organization the old project of colonial pedagogy, but through an imperial. So the mandates are an excellent example of this. There is an entire administrative science almost that's developed by the League of Nations on what would later on you could say these are manuals of development that are produced under the League. So that's what happens, it seems to me. And that, of course, then you, to connect it up with my answer to Homi's question, after World War II, it changes.
Since I managed to hear only half the speech, having had a meeting before, I can only ask half a question. It concerns the pedagogy of violence, as I understand. I mean, one of the striking features, especially its outcase, which I heard in with great admiration for your analysis. The argument is extremely consequentialist. The world would be better off. And that, in a sense, is also an analogy with the later things you talk. The American intervention in Iraq is also a very consequentialist argument, very sharply in contrast with the kind of argument, say, Grotius gives in The Law of Sea, or dealing with why the Santa Cristina could be sunk. Not that it's in the interest of the Portuguese or anyone, but it can be done. It's within one's right. Whereas here, it's to be justified, and I guess we're talking mid-19th century, it's post-Bentham, and utilitarianism thought it very strong and powerful at that time, and the consequentialism picture would certainly come up. One of the striking things, however, in that context is the fairly detailed, if you think of consequentialism as a cluster of epistemology and ethics, the epistemic thing is done with a great deal of care from the courts, what's happening in out. And the main failure would be, I would say, in that, I mean, it seemed to me that out probably is indictable in the way it was being indicted. On the other hand, the main failure, and which becomes a big factor immediately in the mutiny and of course later on the nationalist movement to which you refer, is understanding of the episteme of the British rule as to what would happen. What's the alternative that would come up? Mm. And there's a complete failure there because there's always an idea that it's a kind of really good rule that would follow, which of course is a failure. Now, in the case of the interventions like Iraq and so on, of course, what was probably the most outrageous aspect was the carelessness of the epistemology, or the big gaps in the epistemology about who has weapons of mass destruction and so on. And there was a success in a democratic United States for the government to put across a story with basically overwhelming support of the population with, dissent, but nothing like that, of a story which wasn't true. Whereas the striking thing, I'm sounding very pro-imperialist, but the detail with which it contracted as to why there is a moral outrage, and you even mentioned, I've forgotten who, couldn't live in India for very long because the extent of his moral outrage was such that he had to leave. So I think there is, that seems to me to be a kind of contrast. And of course, there is a parliament, and this is a British parliament, and to which it has to be presented, and as we know it already happened earlier with the Warren Hastings and so on, that they could discuss in detail, even though they might miss whether Clive behaved as well as he was thought to have been, and so on. Do you not see a kind of disconnect in some sense between the analogy because of the way the epistemic aspects have become undeminable. I mean, it was undermined, of course, thoroughly in the context of the Indian elections, for example. Most people's perception as to what had happened before, or what had happened in Gujarat compared with, which is seventh in the ranking of growth, 10th in the ranking of per capita income. But this different story changed. So it seems to me that along with the successes of democracy, but because of the possibility of the malleability of the media and the ability not necessarily to buy it, but that too, but to generate a situation which makes the epistemic aspects much weaker, much more manipulable today than even at a time when we are talking of it. Fully democratic Britain, women don't have votes and all kinds of things. And is that something, I haven't read your book and I'm going to read it, but is there something of a contrast, you think, there?
Well, thank you for pointing out this, the consequentialist argument that on which the imperial project is founded in the 19th century. I referred to this because I think that's very important. In the 18th century, the early period of British rule, this consequentialist argument is not made at all. You know, there's almost no mention of the British having any responsibility of good government or anything of this kind. This happens in the 19th century, and you're completely right in saying that Bentham and the utilitarians and so on, and that entire conceptual apparatus becomes extremely important in terms of making the imperial project intelligible, right? And the argument is empire is good because it provides better government than what any Indian rulers ever provided or could provide. Now, the interesting thing that happens, and this doesn't happen in the 19th century, it's only at the turn of the 20th, you begin to get a new nationalist argument which completely rejects this consequentialism, and which basically said it makes no difference whether British rule has produced good government or not, right? That is an irrelevant criterion. British rule is unacceptable because it is alien. Now, this is a completely new kind of argument because it's premised on our ideas of the autonomy of a nation, some kind of natural right of a nation to govern itself. Now, this is a completely new argument which would be called self-determination of nations and peoples, etc., in the 20th century. Now, once that happens, the argument about intervention which will be justified and will be welcomed because of its consequences. You see, this is the problem that I'm trying to raise.
Yeah.
At the beginning of my lecture, I said this is, I don't mean this as a kind of parable, as a moral story.
Yeah.
I mean this to, in a sense, excavate our collective memory so as to not give us, too hopeful accounts that somehow violent actions which might lead to good results would somehow be welcomed and be justified. That's not necessarily the case. And I think both the Awadh argument as well as many, many other examples one can produce from imperial histories, which
just,
will show exactly.
Just as a follow-up question, and I see that very clearly. Thank you. And in bringing about this change from the 18th to mid-19th century, presumably there's some linkage with the political philosophy literature, which
is
one of the things that happened
yes.
in between, of course,
yes.
as Bentham becomes the dominant
yes.
figure. I mean, oddly enough, of course, at the time when the Awadh is happening, it's quite close to the time when Marx is writing German ideology
yes.
and non-domination, which is the non-consequentialist part
true,
of Marx,
true, true.
In contrast with, say, Gotha
true.
Program or Capital, which are very, very consequentialist. I mean, the oddity is that at the time when the non-dominant argument, and just led by Marx, a lot of people take that up, becomes dominant, mm-hmm. is also the time when the consequentialist argument has sufficient root mm-hmm. in people political thinking. That justification, I mean, that was very striking how detailed the justifications were on that side. Yeah.
Oh, yes.
So I think other people are waiting there, but I don't want to take on more that time than that.
Well, if anyone's waiting, speak up now. Well, yes. Final question.
Yes, I had a question about. My name is Anila Dolodzai. I'm from the Divinity School faculty in the Divinity School. I'm an anthropologist of Afghanistan. And I wanted to ask specifically, in your book, do you talk about the contemporary only about the Iraq? Or do you, I'm looking forward to reading this new book, but also about the discourses relevant to Afghanistan that might have been rooted? Or
I don't really talk about, the more recent period. I really talk in much more general terms about the recent period because as Sugata was saying, that the more detailed history sort of stops around sometime in the 1940s. Mm-hmm. I do make connections with what happens afterwards, more in a kind of global context. Mm-hmm. But I have absolutely no discussion of the specific history of Afghanistan at all.
Not particularly about the history of Afghanistan, but about invasion and the discourses, because you're talking about Iraq, and I'm wondering if you see them differently, or do you see the justifications
for
Afghanistan?
Well, yes, there could well be specific differences between the invasion of Afghanistan, because in a sense the specific justifications were different, because the argument for Afghanistan was, well, there was actual violence directed from there by whoever these people were. But they were meant to be supposedly located in that place, and therefore the attack was, or the invasion of Afghanistan was initially justified by those terms. Iraq was a very different argument because there was no immediate provocation, and so in a sense the whole argument about there possibly being weapons of mass destruction, and we know, but then once that argument fell to the ground. The argument always is, but what's happened since is better than what existed before.
Also, just to add to that, as if I recall, the American government asked for the Taliban at that time for Bin Laden to be
delivered.
Over.
Yeah.
So it was even more part of this. He asked for it to be handed over. They refused it. Anyway. Partha Chatterjee, thank you very much.
Thank you.
It's been a great pleasure.